Hi everyone. So this talk is about Presto, building cross-platform transactional apps using functional programming. So this is going to be a bit different talk from the earlier ones in regards to so most of the talks that I heard was mostly aimed at like a dashboard kind of app. So just being a mobile app company, we mostly build SDKs that are transactional in nature. So like a payments app when you send money, when you receive money, or search for people to send them money, all the other transactions. So this is mostly targeted at transactional apps. So my name is Kalkhuria and I am a UI engineer at Juspay, and I have been working as an engineer for 2.5 years. So as I was saying about Juspay, so Juspay is basically a SDK company where you might have seen the Juspay logo for multiple apps. So it's been powering 100 million devices, and we have also built Deep. So you guys might have used Deep. So that we built, and that was built basically using Presto and Presto UI. So so why we built Presto UI? So what we thought was, in the app development or the UI development framework, there's a basic problem of how the process is there. So what I mean by the process is, generally, let's say you want to develop a UI, right? So there are basically four people involved. So one is the designer, second is like a guy who develops a screen, and third is like a guy who basically writes the logic part, wherever the controller, platform specific stuff, like people writing Android code and web-based code. And the final guy is like the product guy, which basically, you know, sees the code and puts the actual logic. So what we thought was, fundamentally, the existing set of frameworks were not fit for that purpose. For example, I would say, so the apps that we build are transactional in nature, which means that the sequence of flow is very important. So for example, let's say you want to take a send money flow example, right? So in any app, if you want to send money, if you send money to someone, so you basically land in a home page, let's say in a theme or a home page, and then you basically click that option, and then you basically keep on drilling down and you reduce the number of options. So when you're writing a flow-based code, when you're trying to write this in a reducer format or like in the Redux existing way, it's really hard to track, you know, what is happening and what happened before anything, because there's no real order in the reducer code, right? Because in dashboard it makes sense because there are multiple events coming in. But if you think like a simple payments app, where you basically from the home page you start reducing all your options. So if you select an option like a send money, you just keep do that and you'll finish off with a transactional. So that's why I was saying for making transactional apps, that's what I mean. And then if you choose an option for like a receive money, then you basically are going through that path, and then you're basically finishing that off that transaction. So as I was saying, so basically there are three building blocks. First is the UI. Second is the platform itself, where we are writing platform specific code, and third is the flow, which is the logic part. So we have been using JavaScript both in the backend and the front end. In the backend, we have been using Node.js, and in the front end, we are using vanilla JavaScript and multiple frameworks like React and Redux. So we so because Juspay is an SDK company, and we create SDK for third party companies, like so we create SDK for, like, we have created for Google, Amazon. So we will provide our SDK, and then that is basically pushed inside the app. So back in 2015, because we were doing these kind of things, so one of the requirements for us is that, you know, we can't rely on the shipment cycle of the third party person, right? So because the app has to be controlled by us. So for that reason, we had to create HTML5 apps so that we can, whatever the logic is there, if you want to change it from our hand, we can basically update the bundle.js, and that's where the code is fixed. Because if we create like native apps, and then it has to go through their development cycle, and then it becomes really difficult for us to, you know, make any changes. But as you know, in the mobile world, like, first we had like a problem of the performance itself. So if you know, like, HTML5 apps, as good as they are and as good as their APIs are, because the browser and the Chrome engine is not as good as the web-based engine. So in an existing like a Uber app or an Amazon app, and as soon as you move to like a HTML5 app, so you clearly notice the difference. So we couldn't just use a UX app. Back there, like the React Native was not that dominant. So and then the second requirement, we couldn't use a React Native for building a mobile app because of the size. So our requirement for creating SDK is basically like a 1.5 because it's a third party country, so you can't afford. So these are the two basic challenges we had. We had to create a very small, like you can say, a React Native, which is just targeted for creating like a transactional kind of mobile app. So we basically had to bring down a lot of features from it. So that's what I'm going to talk about. And so the first part is UI. So we also had this, as I talked, that there are fundamentals to all the UI development process. So first is the UI. So whenever the UI is created from the designer, so it's basically there's a lot of thought process involved in it, right? So if you know Sketch, so in Sketch basically you will create multiple designs, and then you they have the same concepts as like you know symbols, where a same component has been used in multiple places. It's just as a component you guys create, they guys already have this logic. So the problems that we have currently is the design handover. There's no proper tool for design handover. So a lot of times myself when I was developing the UI code, a design would be given to me, and I wouldn't know if this thing is in the center or it is supposed to be like a multi-pixel from the top. So all these things basically are really like all missed in the all the translation of the tools. There are tools like Zeppelin and stuff, but basically they'll just translate the you know sketch values or the Photoshop values to just whatever Android or web values. But all those small details are what missed. And second is the pixel perfection. So as good as the human you know brain is, it's really hard if to create a pixel perfect design, because it takes a lot of time. As Android APIs are different and the scaling units are different, web has a different scaling unit, and obviously iOS has like a point based metric. So, and if you see the pixel perfection part, like there's a lot of redundant UI work that a designer, developer has to do. And when it goes to multiple iterations, it's like really hard to make sense. You know what to what's the correct logic behind doing all this. So for this, what we did is created a Presto panel. So Presto panel is basically a sketch plugin that sits on top of a sketch file, and what it does, it auto generates view code. So it auto generates a view code that is compatible across Android, iOS, and Web. And the way it does this, I'll show you an example. So this is a sketch, you guys might have already seen it. So in sketch you have basically like pages. So pages you can think of like flows. So one page will basically cover like a send money flow. So it will have all the artboards of like a send money, whatever different screens are there in an app. And then you will have multiple artboards. So let's say this is one login kind of flow where you have a splash screen, then you have a login screen, and then you have a profile screen. So what our plugin does is basically, so in the side you see this is a Presto panel that we have added. So there are multiple options we have added. So let's say you want to make this thing edit text. So you can basically say it's an edit text, and we will take this bit meta JSON and adapt it. So the way it works is basically, so you have a sketch design which is open in your sketch file, and you run through the sketch plugin. So sketch design generates app.sketch, that is the file basically being generated by the sketch. So what that file is basically a hierarchy. So if you see already there is already a hierarchy, right? So if you see the profile screen, I have a main screen, I have an email, like an email group, I have a mobile group, and all these things. So if you see, all this effort has already been put by the designer. And then again, the developer has to put the same effort. Like, so there's a already this hierarchy of work is already there. Now this sketch told him, like, if you just basically select this element and you say a type, it's an edit text. So this, so the ID that is associated with this element will be basically, there will be a tag saying this ID is an input box. And then basically, we combine both this JSON, and then there's a parser we have written which basically reads both the JSON and generates a common UI code. So basically, so let's say this group, right? So you can see, yeah, so this group. So this group has two elements, right? So this is the thing, and this is the label, and this is the name. So if you have an Android, there's a linear layout where you can say it's a vertical orientation to align one after another. So whatever plugin will do is basically pass over this loop and attach a meta information saying this is a orientation vertical. So when once this information is attached here, basically this basically reads both this JSON and combines the code. So I'll show you the code, how the code looks like. So this is the code that is being generated. So if you see there is the linear layout and all these properties are there. So if you see height equal to match parent, width equal to match parent. So these are our responsive properties, right? These are all properties are basically being assigned by our plugin. So how that works is basically if you see this box, right? There's a padding of 20-20 on each side. So that would basically mean if a device is small, 20-20 should be on each side, and then it should take whatever space remaining, right? So all this logic that our plugin calculates and applies proper logic. So the second part is the Presto UI part. Basically, this is the part which takes the app.sketch and app.sketch.json and generates a cross-platform UI code. And as I told you, why we had to do it, because we wanted a very small core itself. So if you see the React Native, it has a Chrome like an engine already shipped in with it. So we don't use that, we basically use the WebView itself to pass the JSON and render views. So that's why it's basically small and it fits the Hasgeek requirement also. So we decided to go with the Android DSL. So the DSL is basically decided to go with the Android as the face for all the three platforms. So basically if you have this code, this will render UI for a web also, for an Android also, and for iOS also. So the reason we went with this DSL is because we thought that first is like a web DSL is like really flexible. You can do anything you want. And frankly it makes also sense because you have to create different type of apps. You have a dashboard apps, you create a game, all those things are there. But how I use this was basically to be able to create a mobile app that is transactional in nature. So we chose this DSL because we found that things like gravity equal to center. Gravity equal to center. So if you have ever done web programming and want to set up something in the middle of a box, so you will have to ask question whether this thing is static, whether the child is static, whether the parent is like dynamic. All these questions has to be asked. Wherever if you have done Android, you basically just have to say gravity equal to center. The child parent element will automatically center the element within itself. And then there are other DSLs like linear layout. You basically say if you want to put something side by side, you basically say orientation horizontal. If you want to put something below the, you just say vertical. So if you see the same thing in like an iOS, basically that is like point is, you just basically have to say x20 and then the other way x40 if you want to put side by side. So all these things are like, and in web you have to say inline block and then by default is like one below the other. So all this if web is and iOS we found that they don't really represent that correctly, and Android DSL we found it to be really simple to understand. So if you basically say the orientation is vertical, you easily understand okay these things are one below the other. So that's why we decided to go with this DSL. So the third part in this is flow. So then the next part comes in where you write the flow. So the current challenge is, as I mentioned, is so when somebody writes a flow, So the product managers and developers basically are talking two different languages. The product manager is mostly looking at it in terms of the flow. So so if you know that, like, the flow diagram, so first this action happens, then it based on like if else case, some condition is matched, and then you move on to the next node. And that way the product manager is looking at it. It doesn't care what screen and what. So it basically is unaware of the screen. So wherever the developers are basically, because there are so much of tied into, you know, small changes in the UI, like a validation. So let's say there's an input, there's a login form where there are two, you know, username and password, there's a subfilter, right? So all the product manager cares about how you get the values and how you when someone submit, you get the data and you send it back. So that small details of validation, right? It shouldn't be visible from the top level. Wherever if you see from our current code, the way we have written React or Vue, right? Everything is just covered. You can't basically, if you just basically remove the view part, you can't just see the flow and understand the app, how the app is working, right? But basically that's how the app is working. The validation part is just a very minor part. You can change it, you can enhance it by, you know, having some even complex logic. But so these are the bigger problems we had. And second is the code visibility, because there's so much coupling of the code. It's impossible to basically figure out what's happening. So for that we created something called Presto Flow. And so we have been using functional programming for quite a while. Even when we were using JavaScript, we were using Swift.js. So if you know Swift.js, basically it tries to, you know, bring in all the things, some of the things that are there in these JavaScript and type languages. We also tried Flow. So if you know Flow, basically it adds static type compile check. So and time by time, and then we were using Rx also. So basically what we thought, why not use JavaScript based? Because we are just keep adding libraries to libraries on JavaScript just to make it something like functional. So we just thought, why not use JavaScript, which is type and which will give static type compiling and has all the other features of our purely functional language. So this is, if you see this code, so let's say this is an example bill payments page. So this is the new flow language we have come up with. Just by looking at this code, you can figure out what's happening in the app. You don't really need to create any UI, you can even have a dummy UI. So if you see the first line, it says basically UI.splashScreen. So it basically says show me the splash screen. So this is a do notation, and this is some kind of more app. So basically what's happening is it's waiting for some kind of response. So it basically shows the splash screen and immediately comes back. I don't really care about the value because it's kind of showing the splash screen. Second statement is like saying remote.fetch operator. So then I'm getting the list of operators. So this is like a mobile recharge screen. So you need to get the list of operators, then you will select from it, then you will output how much money you want to, you know, recharge, and then you will send back a message to the backend, right? So that's all the information that should be there at the top layer of the code. I don't really care about how it's implemented in the UI. Definitely, the guy who is implementing that, he has to take care of all the pixel perfection and how he manages the state. But at some layer, there has to be like a, you know, distinction that, you know, this is the flow code and it can work with any kind of UI. So if you see, you basically say remote.fetch operator, and this is like an API call, which will keep on waiting until you get the operator. So this is what I was talking about when I was saying in readers you can't really figure out like what's the order of the flow. So this, if you see, this is like complete flow based. So before one thing, the next thing cannot happen. So if you say, it will say remote.fetch operators, you get the operator. Now UI.useOperator. So basically whenever we say UI dot, right, it basically says show me the screen. And you are getting the list of operators and you are sending it to that screen. So basically, there's a clear separation. So basically, the UI guy can just write his UI, assume that a list of operators is coming and enter the screen. Meanwhile, the flow guy can just basically write a flow and pass his arguments. So he'll basically call the screen, choose the operators, and he'll get choose the operator and it will enter the screen. Now, this operator is the operator that is being selected by the user. So as soon as the user selects any of the operator from the list of operator, this call will finish and he will get the operator. Next thing is it's saying UI dot ask mobile number. So facing, and now you are asking for a mobile number. You get the mobile number, you ask the amount. You finally, as soon as you get the amount, you make a remote API call and with the mobile number and amount, and you get the result, and you basically get success. So if you see in this story, I can just write an entire code just by without having any UI. We are even working on like a dummy based UI, where basically if you say UI dot like these are basically very domain specific, but if you can say UI dot show me a list, so it can generate a dummy list based on some kind of parameter values. So that is there. So I have a demo for the sketch plugin part. I'll show you that. So this is a preview of the sketch plugin. So this is the code being generated. So if you want to see, so if you see, this is, these are all basically generated. So wherever there is a class, basically that means there is a tag on the UI. That's how the code has been written. So the all being generated from the Android user. So if you think there's any issue, all these things are there. So I have opened a sketch plugin. So let's say I just make a change of some color. And then I have run this command. What this command basically does is interpret this thing and generate a new JSON. It basically will say that this element has a this color. That will be fed into the meta JSON file. So when I save it, these are the things that we have basically developed: Presto UI, Presto Pro, and Presto Panel. So Panel is the part basically in the sketch plugin part, which takes your sketch code and generates the static UI. And Pro is the part basically where you write DSL based code, which is sequential in nature. So this is not something which you can use in like a dashboard. So this is basically for writing sequential code. Third is the cross platform, like a small React native part, which we needed because of the Hasgeek requirement, and also frankly we didn't need that heavy thing because when the user is going to download it's better if it's a smaller app. So we have open sourced this project named as Presto UI, which is the panel part, and this is the Presto JavaScript, which is the flow part. So we'll be happy if you start contributing and at least taking this approach. So this is basically mostly for mobile app, as the reducer part is not really figured out. So the reducer part is really hard. So if you can think of one screen of a mobile app can be as big as like your dashboard of a entire one big app. So if you have multiple screens, then it's really hard to track. So maybe we can contribute and follow this approach. So, great.
Thanks, Naman. Give a round of applause to this amazing session.